Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. In case you don't know me, my name is Izzy, and I have a genetic disorder that's called hypermobile Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome. Now, a bunch of you actually reached out to me over the past 24 hours, letting me know that Dr. Mike did another video talking about EDS, and I obviously wanted to react to it, so I'm really excited to do that. Just for a little bit of background about me, so you kind of understand where I'm coming from, I'm not a doctor, but like I said, I have EDS, and I also did research for 11 months on classical EDS. I'm also about to start my master's in genetic counseling at the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai to hopefully help people who have EDS as well as a bunch of other genetic conditions. So with that, let's get into reviewing this video. It's also really short, by the way. I just want to say it's literally called a YouTube short because it's short. Okay.
Diseases doctors often miss. Episode 1. EDS, or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, is a genetic condition that affects the connective tissues of the body, leading to hypermobile skin or joints.
So, just to pause it right there. I do like his intro. I would say one thing that I hope he gets into is that this disease can have quite a spectrum of severity when it comes to mainly skin stretchiness. It is interesting that he said hypermobile joints or stretchy skin, because I believe that all types of EDS come with some level of hypermobile joints, whether it's generalized hypermobility or sometimes it's really just peripheral hypermobility, such as in the vascular type. So it's interesting that he used the word or, but again, like maybe there is a type that I don't know about that doesn't come with hypermobile joints. But yeah, also not every type requires stretchy skin. For example, with the type of EDS that I have, which is the hypermobile type, and it used to be called type 3, by the way, in case you run into that title, it does not require you to have stretchy skin in order to pass the criteria. However, a lot of people do, but some people just have soft skin. I have stretchy skin. It's not crazy stretchy, but like you can see, I can definitely stretch my hands. I'd say like my neck stretches a bit more. It's nothing crazy like the guy that he showed, but you know, stretchy skin does come with it oftentimes.
A condition that affects the connective tissues of the body, leading to hypermobile skin or joints. But because of the hypermobility, patients often present with repeated injuries, like dislocations, sprains, and even fractures. In fact, there are actually 13 subtypes, some of which can affect the skin, heart, blood vessels, and bones.
I'm really happy he said that it can affect all of these different body parts like blood vessels, skin, and bones, because that's totally true. I feel like oftentimes even physicians will talk about this condition and solely focus on the orthopedic effects of it, which is kind of damaging for some people when their main symptom, or at least their most worrisome and bothersome symptom, is something such as POTS, which is like a type of dysautonomia, or gastroparesis, or something else that's like comorbidity of the condition, and affects them a lot worse than just their joints. Around 40% of people who have EDS have POTS, which is a type of dysautonomia. It's also called postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. And this is where, I guess just on a very basic definition level, whenever you stand up, your heart rate increases a lot more than it's supposed to. And that leads to a lot of symptoms like dizziness and fainting and presyncope, heat intolerance. I know for me, showering is extremely difficult and exhausting, and it requires many hours for me to recover from showering, which is really hard considering that, you know, I try to shower every day or like every other day if I don't feel up to it, but it sucks that that's, you know, something that we have to deal with. Let's continue.
Actually 13 subtypes, some of which can affect the skin, heart, blood vessels, and bones. No cure is currently known, and patients who are diagnosed can be treated with a combination of physical therapy, medications, or surgery. Too often, patients with EDS are overlooked and treated as hypochondriacs, when the reality is this condition requires more attention and more recognition. Subscribe for episode number 2.
So he's totally right. This condition is oftentimes overlooked, but more than that, the validity of somebody's condition is oftentimes questioned by physicians, by friends, and other people, which is really, really damaging, especially when you're yet to be diagnosed. I actually have a very interesting statistic to talk about, which is that there is a mean of 14 years elapsed between the first clinical symptom and the actual diagnosis of EDS, which is a very, very long time. I'm trying to think, I guess my first symptoms, I had a pretty bad dislocation of my knee when I was 8. But I really started subluxing my knee when I was 6, and 6 is also when I started developing pain when I was writing. So I would say the first symptom started out when I was 6 years old, and I got diagnosed in 2017, so I would have been 20, Oh my gosh. So I was it took me 14 years. That's actually funny. I'm right at the mean. And that's a very long time. I was actively looking for a diagnosis. I mean, very, very actively, maybe at 14 or 15, but even around 10, I was experiencing chronic joint pain and a ton of injuries. And it didn't take long for me to start realizing, okay, like there's definitely something going on. You know, maybe I just have something wrong with a few of my joints. It's kind of weird. But at a certain point, like it was just so obvious that there really was something systemic going on. And I really wish so badly that I'd been diagnosed earlier and that it was caught earlier so that I could do the right kinds of physical therapy, that I could stop certain activities or just do them, you know, with lesser frequency so that way I don't hurt myself. I do think it would have saved me a lot of injuries that I still deal with to this day. Additionally, 56% of patients in this one study that I'm looking at here were first misdiagnosed. I know I was misdiagnosed with fibromyalgia. Also, literally every single one of my physicians, like, I mean, probably 15 of them, were convinced I had an autoimmune disease that was just not yet showing up on my blood tests because I was pretty young, and they said sometimes it can take a little while to show up. I don't really understand how it works, but that's what they told me. So we just kept checking and kept checking and kept checking, and nothing was showing up. So at a certain point, they just did not know what to do. And it was really hard because when I was not diagnosed, I didn't have any symptom management whatsoever other than taking Advil, a lot of Advil, literally every single day, which I still take a lot more than I'd like to, but it is what it is. But anyway, I also have other ways that I manage my pain, like other medications. And if I could have had those earlier, I do think that would have really helped me. Now, there are two things that I think Dr. Mike really missed in this video. And I'm going to play the beginning half and show you where I think he should have put the thing I'm about to talk about. Wow, I'm doing a lot of prefacing. I don't know why. I'll just play the video.
Diseases doctors often miss, episode 1. EDS, or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, is a genetic condition that affects the connective tissues of the body, leading to hypermobile skin or joints. But because of the hypermobility, patients often present with repeated injuries, like dislocations, sprains, and even fractures. In fact, there are actually 13.
So here, I believe he really missed a huge, huge point, which is that we deal with so much chronic pain. Now, I have met many doctors who don't even think EDS can cause pain. I've told this story before, but back when I was suspecting I might be dealing with EDS and I asked a couple of doctors for their opinions, all of them said, honestly, maybe, I have no idea. And other than one of them who said, EDS only affects the eyes and your heart, and it can't cause pain. So obviously you don't have EDS because I don't have issues with my eyes. It just like didn't make any sense. She was so wrong, and it's hurtful, you know, to look back on that and also think that she might be saying that to patients even to this day. And I don't know, that just does not sit with me well. But anyway, I am surprised that he did not mention chronic pain. So this study says that approximately 90% or more of EDS patients suffer from chronic pain. So that's a lot. Another study says that 97% of people with hypermobile EDS deal with severe chronic pain, and for 75% of them, it just gradually gets worse. So you can see that chronic pain is a huge, huge part of EDS, and it really distinguishes somebody who just randomly has some hypermobile joints and has literally no problems from somebody who is EDS, who is also hypermobile, but deals with injuries, but also chronic pain. And, you know, I do just want to say I'm so grateful that somebody with a big social media presence like Dr. Mike is talking about our condition. I think that's fantastic. And I do think he said a lot of great things. I just think that that chronic pain was one really important point that I believe he really should have spoken about, because this leads me into my next point, which is that he didn't really talk about how hypermobility is normal. You know, 10 to 20% of the population, depending on what study you look at and what hypermobility test they use, is hypermobile. So I worry that people are going to be watching this video and say, oh my gosh, I can touch my thumb to my wrist. Oh my gosh, my elbows hyperextend. I have EDS. And while somebody might be like, well, that doesn't matter because they're not diagnosed with it. Well, this is what I say. First of all, I think that it's really damaging for EDS to be, you know, thrown around in a kind of like a non-serious manner, because this condition really is very disabling for so many people, and it you know, causes me to have some level of disability as well. And I don't think that it's okay to just throw it around and pretend like it's not that big of a deal. It also then turns this life-altering condition into something that isn't life-altering in the minds of some. So they just might not think that it's a big deal, and that's already something that so many people with EDS deal with. I know I've been questioned by friends, by other people, or at least I feel like I'm being questioned by them based off of their expressions or things I've heard people say. But even if I have not had the strongest experiences of people being, you know, very, very rude and not believing my story and my condition, so many of you in the comments have told me your stories, and it's just unbelievable and it's heartbreaking to hear how many people have just dismissed you and have not believed you, have called you a hypochondriac, have called you crazy. And I love that he said that, because that's true. So many people think they are a hypochondriac, but I think he might be potentially slightly in some way might be contributing to that just a little bit by not talking about the other symptoms of this condition and by not talking about how hypermobility and some of these things on their own are totally normal. You know what I mean? It downplays a serious condition and it changes it in the eyes of people who are supposed to be taking care of us, i.e. medical professionals, and it makes it seem like it's not a big deal. So that way if somebody comes in with dislocating joints or chronic pain or both, a doctor's like, nah, yeah, guys, you have EDS, but it's no big deal, just deal with it. You know, I don't know, like, that might just sound dramatic to some, but I'm serious, that happens. So I feel like I'm dragging on, but I do worry that by a video like this, it can come off a little bit wrong to some people, you know, and they might take, what their takeaway might be from this video is that I'm hypermobile. Oh, I've sprained something before. Ah, I have EDS. I mean, of course it's possible. I would never be here gatekeeping and saying that you can't have it. I don't freaking know. I'm not your doctor. I'm not a doctor. But that can be harmful when a bunch of people do that and like they don't have EDS. So yeah, I think you know where I'm going. It's like we want our condition to be talked about, but you want it to be talked about correctly and also in its entirety. And I understand it's only 37 seconds, but also shorts can be up to 60 seconds. So I do wish he had literally for 3 seconds said it's a very painful condition. I also want to bring up this other study that I just searched so far and wide for and I cannot find it. So I'm so angry. I'm sorry. I will put it down below in the description if one day I find it. oh, I'm so annoyed I can't find it. But it was basically, it was a pretty good study too, I liked it. It was saying that there are two types of patients with EDS that present to clinic. And this is just a generalization. This is not, you know, like only these two. The first is people who come in with repeated injuries, dislocations, tendonitis, sprains, and that is like their primary symptom as a kid. These are all kids that they were talking about. And so that is kind of the side that Dr. Mike talked about. The other one was that they come in with chronic pain, daily chronic pain in their joints and muscles. I fell a little bit more towards that latter category, and I think a lot of us do as well. But I also sort of fit into the first category. I'm kind of a mix of both, and I think most people are, but like, you know, that was kind of the two categories the study was talking about. And Dr. Mike sort of like sidestepped that whole category, so which like sort of sucks. It's again talking about the chronic pain thing. So hopefully Dr. Mike makes another video one day. I know he's given a lot of attention to this condition recently, which is cool. But I do hope that he can talk a bit more about this stuff. So thanks for joining me. I would really love it if you considered subscribing to my channel to learn more about EDS and POTS. And I used to have a condition called gastroparesis, so I do talk a bit about that, but luckily that's a lot better now. So I will see you guys on the next video. Bye.